Dear students, in this session we will learn about the interesting features and evolutionary significance of dipnoi. Now this term dipnoi may be quite new to you. As the name suggests, di means two, noi means respiratory organs. So here in these fishes you find two different kinds of respiratory organs and hence you call it as dipnoi. Now, what are the common respiratory organs in case of fishes? It is gills, isn't it? So here, these dipnoi, they actually respire with the help of gills, and also in addition to gills, they have developed lungs so that it can, support the process of respiration during extreme conditions. And because of this, people thought that these dipnoi, since they come after fishes, like from fishes, it has shown little modifications in developing gills. And after fishes, the next phylum that evolved is amphibians. So earlier they thought that maybe amphibians would have evolved from these dipnoi, or this dipnoi would have given rise to amphibians, but now this concept does not hold good anymore. Now we have understood how different dipnoi and amphibians are. So by the end of the session, you will understand as to how these two have evolved independently. So basically, these dipnoi are nothing but the bony fishes, and they, in addition to gills, have developed lungs for the purpose of respiration. And since they show two different respiratory organs like the gills and the lungs, they are classified under dipnoi, and the common name for them are lungfishes, right? So in this session, we will learn much in detail about their characters, how do they appear externally, what are their internal characters, and what are their evolutionary significance. I am Dr. Lata, Assistant Professor in Zoology, Maharani Science College for Women, Bengaluru. So now let us learn in detail about dipnoi and their interesting features. Now we said why these are called as dipnoi. Dipnoi are commonly called as lungfishes, and they belong to the order Sarcopterygii of Osteichthyes, that is bony fishes. They are double breathers. Because why double? We said di means two, noi means the breathing structures. So here they show, or they breathe with the help of two structures. One is the gills and the other one is the lungs. So because of that, they are also called as double breathers. And they mainly appear during this mid-Devonian period, and they flourished moderately in Permian and Triassic era, and then they become rare. The earliest recorded fossil lungfish is Dipterus of mid-Devonian era. So at present there are only three living genera of lungfishes. Why we specify living genera? Because only these three genus of these lungfishes are seen even today. The others are all extinct now. They no more found anywhere in the world. Now the three living genera of these lungfishes are Neoceratodus, which is found in Australia. So it is called as an Australian lungfish. Protopterus, which is an African lungfish, and Lepidosiren, which is found in South America, and then it is called as American lungfish. So these are the only three living genera of lungfish. Now these lungfishes, they exhibit discontinuous distribution because they are seen only in these three continents of Africa, South America, and Australia. So there, the distribution if you look at the distribution of these lungfishes in these three different continents, that tells you like how they are discontinuous in distribution, and they are not found all throughout the world. Now this map also shows you like where you find the living lungfishes confined to Australia, a small patch in Australia, Africa and South America. In rest of the places where triangles are marked, they show fossilized lungfishes. It means once upon a time they would have existed all throughout the world. When this continental drift and all happened, they got confined only to these three continents, thereby exhibiting a discontinuous distribution. Now these are the three living genera of lungfish that we said just now. One is Neoceratodus frosteri, which is an Australian lungfish, and then African lungfish is Protopterus ancestens, and the South American lungfish Lepidosiren paradoxa. So observe for their shape and their size, their fins and all. So based on that we can discuss like how do they live, in which habitat they are found and other details. Now if you observe this Neoceratodus, they are the only species, there is a single species that is Neoceratodus of frosteri found in the Burnett and Mary rivers in Queensland, Australia, and they are the direct descendants of ancient lungfish. It attains a length of 1.5 meters and a weight of around 45 kgs. That is Neoceratodus. Then when you look at Protopterus, African lungfish, there are around four species of them which are found in the rivers of Senegal, White Nile and Zambezi, and Lake Tanganyika of Africa. They grow up to 1 to 2 meters and they also weigh around 40 kilos. The Lepidosiren, the American lungfish, they are the species that is found is Lepidosiren paradoxa. Even this is a single species that is observed, and they are found in the Amazon River and its tributaries, and that also weighs around 35 to 40 kilos. And their length will almost vary from 1.1 to 1.5 meters. Now these lungfishers, they are large bizarre fishes inhabiting semi-permanent fresh waters and swamps in their habitat like South America, Africa and Australia. They all can survive extremely stagnant waters. They periodically come out to the surface and gulps air into their lungs. Neoceratodus respires exclusively through gills only and uses its single lung only under stress. So because it has a single lung, it is also called as pneumonia refers to lung. Since it has only one lung, it is called as monopneumonia. So this, you know, if you prevent this Neoceratodus from coming out, or if you take it out of the water, it gets choked. So it needs water, and it is the only aquatic lungfish out of all the three. Whereas Lepidosiren and Protopterus, they have weakly developed gills and will drown if prevented from reaching the surface to use their paired lung. That means they mainly depend on lungs for respiration compared to gills. They are all sluggish bottom dwellers and predaceous carnivores, feeding on worms, mollusks, crustaceans, small fishes, and at times even they feed on their own species. So besides swimming in water by undulating body movements, they also crawl on the bottom using their paired fins like legs. Here if you observe their fins, they do not resemble the fin of a fish. They are very thin and slender, and they act as, you know, legs, like they help them to crawl at the bottom of the ocean. And the South American Lepidosiren and the African Protopterus species, they survive even drought by aestivating in the mucus cocoon buried in the bottom mud of their dried up habitats. And they secrete such a thick mucus that they form a cocoon around it, and then they keep respiring with the help of the air that comes through the pore of the sand cocoon. And they also exhibit a high degree of parental care, wherein male Protopterus, they vigorously guard eggs laid by the female in an oval muddy pit or the nest after fertilization. And even Lepidosiren, they exhibit an altogether different kind of parental care, wherein their pelvic fins, they develop some vascular tufts during breeding season. So this male periodically leaves the nest to engulf atmospheric air and oxygen that diffuses from freshly aerated blood to pelvic fin to the vicinity of the eggs or the young for respiration and growth. So this pelvic fins will become more vascular and thereby helping the young one to survive. Now, when you look at the peculiarities of this lungfishers in terms of its external morphology, these lungfishers are slender, fish-like or eel-like creatures. If you look at it, you can make out that it's a fish. And they extend up to 1 to 2 meters in length. They have paired pectoral and pelvic fins. But these fins, as I said, they don't serve the function as it serve in fishes, but rather they are designated as limbs because they are narrow and lobe-like. In some, they are filamentous with a central axis of flesh and bone. The dorsal, anal, and the caudal fins, they are all fused into continuous, symmetrical, diphyseal tail supported by partly calcified fin rays. You can see these fins here. When you observe, see all these fins are fused in all the three. Right? So snout is depressed, both bearing external nostrils enclosed within the upper lip. You can look at these snout here of all these three. They look flattened or depressed. Gills are covered on either side by an operculum. Spiracles are absent. The anus, the urinary, and the genital apertures, and one or two abdominal pores lie within a small ventral cloaca. Eyes are small. Lateral line system is well developed, especially on the head, that helps them to have a balance. And skin is covered by an exoskeleton of thin, bony, overlapping cycloid scales. So these are some of the morphological features that is seen, which you can observe externally. So this is what we have said so far. Now, when we talk about the internal characters, like they exhibit endoskeleton, which is cartilaginous. Their notochord is persistent with cartilaginous vertebral arches, but they lack vertebral centra. Anterior vertebrae are fused with skull. Premaxillae and maxillae are absent. Teeth is modified as crushing plates because that help them to chew on these molluscan shells and other harder stuff since they are bottom dwellers. There are 4 to 6 cartilaginous branchial arches. Jaw suspension is autostylic. The pectoral girdle is a stout cartilage with a pair of investing bones on either side. Pelvic girdle is well developed and cartilaginous. And midbrain, you know, it almost gets undivided into optic lobes. The intestine shows the presence of spiral valve. The glottis may be protected by an epiglottis. The internal nares open into mouth cavity, much like those in, like it is found in amphibia. The air bladder or the swim bladder forms a single or a double lung with internal alveoli, as in higher vertebrates. Like this slide shows you how the development of lungs in dipnoi takes place. So here, the air bladder or the swim bladder, it forms a single or a double lung with internal alveoli, like in higher vertebrates, and hence it helps in the process of respiration. Gills may be well developed or reduced. Then when you look at the circulatory system, the auricle and the ventricle of heart and sinus venosus are imperfectly divided. Hence it gives like an approximately three chambered heart kind. And this ventral aorta will be very small. And but this conus arteriosus is partly or fully partitioned. A spiral valve is present there also, and the pulmonary artery is given off on either side from efferent branchial system. So at the outset, the circulatory system, it looks more related to an amphibian kind of circulatory system, as it is seen in tetrapods, and because of that people thought that these amphibians would have evolved from the dipnoids. And midbrain, we said it is not divided into optic lobes. And you find paired oviducts which open anteriorly into the coelom in case of female. And fertilization remains external. Development includes a metamorphosis. The larva may develop suckers and even external gills. So this, in this picture, you can see the spiral valve in the intestine. So it shows around here, if you see how the spiral valves are formed like this, and this forms around 6.5 whorls, means twists, that are there in the intestine. Now when we say that it has been in the form of 6.5 whorls, you can ask me like, what could be its function? Can you guess what could be the function of spiral valve? It mainly helps in, you know, it retains the chyme or the digested food in the intestine for a longer time, so that that delays the movement of food. And here, because intestine is a simple straight tube, so if there are no spiral valve, food will directly and easily pass out of the intestine, and these fissures are not continuous feeders, isn't it? So because of that, the inner mucosal layer of the intestine is thrown into number of folds, giving rise to this spiral pattern, which increases the epithelial absorptive area of the intestine, so that it delay the passage of food or the chyme. So this is seen in dipnoids as well. And this is one circuit to show like how the mixing of blood, or how this respiration takes place during, in both the ways, like when there is no water, this sometimes circuit occurs, thereby they breathe with the help of lungs. And this slide is about the urinogenital system in case of Protopterus, wherein you can see the presence of both excretory organs and the genital organs being present. And here the paired oviducts opens into the coelom in case of females, whereas vasa efferentia carries sperms through excretory opening in case of male. Fertilization is external, as we said, and development occurs through metamorphosis, and parental care is well exhibited by males, that we have already said in the introductory slide. So these are some of the external and internal unique characters of dipnoi. Now, along with this, these dipnoi, they show a lot of affinities with different classes of Pisces, and also with the other tetrapod like this, amphibians. So they show affinities with fishes in general. They show characters like that of a fishes itself. They show affinities with elasmobranchi. They show affinities with holocephali. They show affinities with actinopterygii, crossopterygii, and they also show affinities with amphibians. So because of this double breathing structures, as I said earlier, they thought it would have evolved, or it would have given rise to amphibians, and now it is clear that they don't, dipnoids didn't give rise to amphibians, rather they have evolved in a parallel thing. Like earlier it was thought that these dipnoids are the father of amphibia, but now it is not like that. Dipnoids are the uncles of amphibians, that you will know once we discuss the evolutionary significance. And also we said that during drastic condition, these dipnoids will aestivate by forming cocoons around them in the wet mud, and this is how they tolerate the dry season. They make up a cocoon and they'll aestivate inside, and they respire with the help of air that comes through the pores, and they sustain the season. Once it rains and the sand becomes wet, again they come out of the wet mud cocoons and they start living normally. Now, to understand the evolutionary significance, you should look at this slide very carefully. Like from the evolutionary stock, you have actinopterygii forming on one side and sarcopterygians on the other side. Here, from this sarcopterygii, it gave rise to crossopterygians, and parallelly on the other side, it gave rise to lungfishes. Okay, and on the other side, it gives rise to tetrapods. So both these lungfishes and tetrapods, that is amphibians, they have both have arisen, or they have come from the common ancestry, that is crossopterygians. So coming to their phylogenetic significance, phylogeny and its significance, or the evolutionary significance of dipnoids, this was little confusing because of the combined characters with which the dipnoids resemble all other groups of fishes as well as amphibians. So this fossil primitive dipnoid, that is Dipterus, that shows a great similarity with fossil crossopterygians than to their living members. So this gave a clue that during the course of their evolution, the modern dipnoi have undergone several changes or specialization, like the anterior dorsal fin was reduced and eventually lost. Remaining median fins were elongated and fused so that originally heterocercal tail become symmetrically diphycercal. Reduction in number of dermal bones of skull and operculum. Thick bony cosmoid scales modified into thin cycloid scales. Extensive sheet of cosmine covering head and the body was lost. And the fusion of conical teeth into crushing tooth plates to feed efficiently upon the shellfishes, and the air bladders became functional lungs, not unlike those of higher vertebrates. So these evidences indicate that dipnoi are degenerate descendants of crossopterygians, which early dipnoians closely resembled. So this says that these lungfishes have evolved from crossopterygians on one hand, and on the other hand, these crossopterygians are also given rise to tetrapods or the amphibians, and hence lungfishes are not father of amphibians or tetrapods, rather they are the uncles. So with this chart, it is clear that how dipnoids are more related to fishes, right? I hope I've made this point clear to you all. And this question on dipnoi mainly comes for 10 marker, wherein you have to describe about their external features and internal characters. And evolutionary significance, they may ask separately for 3 marks. Or in a 10 mark question only, they may ask you to explain interesting features of dipnoi and their evolutionary significance. And the summary of this session, whatever you have learned, you need to write. So I hope you all enjoyed learning this. Thank you for listening to me. These are the sources from which I have taken the content. And thank you.